Hey, it's Joe Glines, and someone had mentioned that the Zoom API had been updated significantly and that mine was no longer valid. Or to be truthful, I think it's still valid till the end of May here in 2020, but they're closing it out at the end of then, and everything switched to this version 2. And so and the approach to how you do stuff in version 2 is very different than in the initial stuff. So if they were asking if I could update it, so I thought I'd take a look, and I was actually glad I did, for the main reason is because initially I wanted to go pull a list of people who had signed up for my meetings, my AutoHotkey webinar. Even though it's not a webinar, it's not a meeting, I wanted to get a list of their first name, last name, email address, so I could, you know, automate emailing them beforehand, remind them and send stuff after. And I'd have to go manually log into the website and generate a report, wait for that to generate, which would usually, it's pretty fast, but take, let's say, a minute, and then hit export and then save it to a local CSV file and then process that file. So it was pretty annoying. Now the new version 2 of the API has your meeting contacts in it. So I'm going to demonstrate in this. The first thing I did, by the way, is so I didn't do anything major difference. And I also, honestly, I cheated. I didn't really read a lot. I had an app I had created. So under, I don't know where it's development, you got to create your own app, build an app, right? Add some information to it. And then I saw they were talking about all this OAuth 2 authentication, which you can work through, but it's much more complicated. And they also offered this JWT option, which was JavaScript Web Token, I think. It's on my other page. And so I took a look at that, and lo and behold, let me see here. Oh, that screenshot's not going to work. Hold on. Let me bring this over here. I just don't want to show all my credentials. This JWT one changes every so often, and you can update it and get a certain, you know, one that's not as often. But let me, sorry, I thought I had this commented out with the image the way I want it to. So on the very same page where I went to the marketplace and looked at my, I want to come out more stuff. There we go. I was just showing you, I went to the app credentials instead of thinking about the information, and there was an API key, which honestly, that really wouldn't matter, but still, why bother sharing that? I have a secret, it's still there. Now, I'm not actually using either of these things, which is what's interesting in this. I don't even know what this IM chat history token is. I'm not sure what that is, but whatever. And this is when you expanded this JWT token. Oh, this is my screenshot. Can't do it. But it shows here this JWT token and tells you this one's going to expire in 90 minutes. So as long as I don't publish this video right after I do it, no one can, you know, use my token value here. And you can copy it. But I also, you can set it longer, like a week, or even, I think I did one for a year. And so you can configure it here. I also found, they mention right here, this JWT.io website where you can go and pass it credentials, I think, or pass it information, and it will generate your JWT token for you. I did find one link in the forum about it, but I didn't try it. And here's the thing, I don't care, right? Like, my whole goal is just to get to use the API. I don't really care if I understand all the ins and outs, just did it work. So I took the JWT token at the time and shoved it, you know, just into a string form. And let me explain this here a bit too. So, I stored it in a variable. I stored the endpoint, which I just looked at the documentation. Let me close some of these other windows so I don't accidentally share stuff and have to start recording again, which is what I did 5 minutes ago. I went to the documentation and here we go. I looked up this one for list meetings, you know, just to be annoying. Here they show you this, but they don't show you the path. And I didn't see it anywhere on this page. You have to go figure out what the full path is. But I figured that out. I forget how, but you'll see it here. So this is and your user ID can either be, I really don't like their documentation, but your user ID can be either your unique ID or your email address that's associated to your account. And so that's why over here you'll see I have my email address, because I could have looked up my user ID, but I'm using my Gmail with my Zoom account just so it comes in through fast. And I set an endpoint to go get a list of all the meetings, and this one, the next call is the one to get registrants. And then I created a function instead of having it just straight in code. I shoved it into a function because I like functions much better. So we can pass it. So here I'm doing a get request. So that's what gets passed into this type. The endpoint, that's going to be the variable I put in here. So wherever I'm saying I'm going to, query string, which actually I got rid of. So I'm not using it at the moment. You know, I'll leave it as part of the function, but just note, it's blank at the moment. So it doesn't, and I took it out of the call here. This is where it would have been. That's if I wanted to, and I don't even have any in that one. This one, I have some query string parameters I could pass to it, but I'm not using them right now. So let's disregard that. And the token, right? That'll be whatever the active token is at that point in time. It's going to get passed to this function. So when I call the function, it's going to jump down in here, creates the object. Here's the type, which is a get request at this point, and the endpoint. And again, the query string is blank, but the endpoint is going to be to get a list of meetings. And then here is how you, in AutoHotkey, how you pass the authorization. So you put the set request header, authorization, bearer, space, and then put in your variable here, which again, I'm feeding it all through this, right? So this is the bearer token that you get, and you'll have to update, unless you build it for really long and you just leave it. And then, you know, tell it what kind of data you're getting back. In my example, I'm pulling JSON. I didn't check to see if you can pull XML. Maybe you can. The payload is unneeded because we're sending a, payload should be up here. It's one of the things you pass to it. Payload, even though we're doing a get request, I want to have it built into this, right? Now we're not using one, so I'm not going to explain what it is. Watch my other API calls for that on a post request. And then what we're going to do is we're going to take the value that gets returned back, which is just the JSON string, and we're going to, it's funny, this meeting I created, I keep getting these reminders for it, even though I signed up with three accounts, I think. But it's just funny, they keep popping up. Yeah, okay, great. And we're going to parse the JSON, which is just a function I have on my computer, and store it, the return, in this AutoHotkey object. It's going to dump that value to this output window for me, but it also returns it, which we're going to play with here on the next call, not this one. So let me go ahead and launch it, and I'm going to hit my hotkey. You know what? It didn't launch for some reason. Oh, there it goes. Oh, I forgot. I got rid of my hotkeys. Usually I have a hotkey that triggers it, and so I got rid of it. So this is the output that it returned back. Apparently I had, it listed five meetings. Here's the AutoHotkey webinar with the topic. So this is a JSON string, which we could parse and make it pretty, but my end goal, because for this other one to get the, attendees, which is this registrants, this is the meeting ID, this 8200. That was my, I don't know. It's one of these that I was playing with. Meeting ID 6, so it's not that one. 820000. Meeting ID. I don't think I can actually search in this output window, otherwise I'd just search for it. So this is this ID. This is this ID. That's the AutoHotkey web. No, that's the AutoHotkey webinar. Let's just go ahead and work on the next one. So here's the DFW landlord one. I think that's actually the one it was. This is meeting 3. Yeah, here we go. 820. So that's a group I'm working with landlords here. And AutoHotkey webinar again. API demo. So this is the one, this meeting 5 is the one I created. Also this page count, number size, these are information, right? If this page count was more than one, I would want to iterate over this and pull more. Or I can also change this page size to more than 30 and have more of the stuff get pulled back at one time, which is what I did in our meetings call. But now I know this meeting ID for the one I just created for this demo video, meeting 5, where's my ID? Oh, wow, that's weird. What is with that? Hopefully that'll just work. I don't know why it has so many, the dot 0000s after it. Maybe Zoom has made some updates and now has a whole different naming convention. I don't know. But what we're going to do is we're going to change our endpoint now. And I'm going to put that number here. Hopefully it doesn't need all those dots and zeros, but we'll find out. And now, let's see, this is going to go down. It's going to dump the output down here. Let's go ahead and run it. What do you mean it's not been enabled for this meeting? And I used registration for this meeting. That's ridiculous. That doesn't make any sense. I in the meeting, let me see if I can, I'll pause this and I'll come back to it. All right, so I swear I had that set up to be a registered meeting, and somehow I went back in there and it wasn't set up to be registered. So I just turned it back on, and now when I run my script, we get a list of registrants and their info. So here's the page count. This is where, yeah, if you had more than 100 people, well, notice here in my call, I said page size equal 100. This is where normally I'd use my key value pair function, but I thought I'd just keep this simple. I say pull back 100 of the registrants, and it's for that meeting. And so here, notice there was no other, I didn't have address and city and information, but I had the email address, right? I had the first name. I had the last name, right? And it looks like that's about the all the information. Then there's a person two. So here's my email address with the second one, first name, and somewhere in here is the last name, probably alphabetical, maybe something. But so, you know, we could work on actually, let's go ahead and do a little bit with this. So so we're gonna registrants. We're gonna narrow it down. Look, if I put, and I'm using Maestrith's m function here. If I run this, it's gonna put everything in this message box, and this is all the key value pairs with the information, right? But hey, you know what? I don't need to know that the count is one, the page is 100, and this and that, right? All I want to do is to get the registrants info. Particularly with the email address, the first name, and the last name, right? And this I might want to even grab here to have it handy so I can remember it. Oops. We'll go ahead and exit out of the app. So now this registrants, I'm going to say for key value pair in registrants dot, you know what, let's just call this, well, I'll finish typing this first, registrants. Let's call this reg so it's not confusing, right? There. So I'm storing that object that gets returned in reg. And then I'm saying now, hey, for just those things under the object reg registrants, then let's look at the for key value. Let's do a message box. So now when I run this, I keep forgetting I don't have my hotkey. What happened there? Key. Oh, look, I misspelled that. Key value reg registrants. I just think some of them are empty. So let me rerun it. So his is the first one to index key value reg registrants. I would have thought that would have gave me what I want. Okay, so that was my bad. The reg.registrants should have been like registrants dot value. Let's see here. Let's say first name. Let's see if that'll work. Oops, I'm an idiot. I put that in the wrong spot. I wonder why I was confused. Value dot first name. Here we go. That's why I looked at that. I'm like, that looks weird. So there we go. First name. The first time through, it's Joe. The second time, oh yeah, they're all the same first name. Sorry. There we go. So let's rerun it. So we have Schmo, King, and Glines, right? And so let's say, let's put... Go ahead and start working with this. We're going to say, you know what? Since we're going to do multiple, we'll wrap this, move that. Whoa. Move that back up. So that equals last name. Let's borrow from that. Even though first name is always the same, this is, I'd want to grab it, right? This is the name of the actual key in the object. First name, and then... lastly, we'll say email, is equal to email. So that dumped them all. In reality, I didn't even need to do that, but we'll leave it at that. And we're going to say data colon equals first name, a tab, last name, a tab, email. And don't forget to put in your new line feed. Otherwise, it would all get matched up on the same line. So now I'm going to say message box and data. And when I run this, hopefully, if I did this right. So I just pulled out the first name, last names, and email addresses of the attendees. So I'm accessing the object in a way. What I realized was, like, you know what? I could have just put this in here. I don't need to have, let's go ahead and do that just to make sure it's clear. So I could have done this for this last name. That's there. First name. That's here. And email. That's here. I can comment these lines out and rerun it. And basically we get the same thing. So I'm not storing those values as a variable. One important thing that you'd learn from this is that is important, because if you came through and someone was missing a key, it would have been stored from before, and the variable would have had the value from the last person that had a last name, unless you blank it after this. This way you actually don't have to worry about it, because if it's missing, it'll reset it as missing. And this is where I'd save it to a tab delimited file or something, put a header row in and get it exactly the way I want it, or automate it, bringing it right into an email, right? So I could, now I can hit a button, get my list of people, and have automate emails to these people reminding them of whatever they signed up, and here it comes. So I hope that helps in some of the stuff with the new version. I didn't get into the whole OAuth 2, because OAuth 2, if I was creating this to give to people to access for their accounts, I would go that route. But the fact that I'm just using this on my Zoom account, I'm perfectly fine using this JWT token and accessing it that way. So hope that helps. Cheers.